Mansfield.
Picture this as an idea for a video game. It's a post-apocalyptic future or a post-apocalyptic past or an alternative history setting with hints of post-apocalyptica, yeah? And in that world, there are cars and other bewheeled vehicles, right? And get this, they're fighting each other with guns and assorted violent paraphernalia. Sorted, stick a fork in me, I am done. Why does nobody make games like that? Well, the answer could be something related to design worries, the market's appetite, the sense of wonder for gamers coming from exploration and crafting rather than the end of the world and cars with guns. It could be a million other things. Or the answer could be all gaming history has included titles like this until around 2012 when it pretty much sort of stopped. Yes, car combat. Specifically car combat in that post-apocalyptic or near enough post-apocalyptic setting is a genre that made its way onto the gaming scene in the wake of movies like Death Race 2000 and Mad Max, and A Boy and His Dog, and The Omega Man, Planet of the Apes, Soylent Green. The 70s had a hell of a lot of post-apocalyptic tales to tell, didn't it? I wonder why. So in the then current world mood of oh shit, we're all gonna get nuked, it was little surprise video games would copy the films actually trying to articulate the paranoia of an entire world's people. So we got Death Race, and we got Auto Duel, and we got Road War 2000, a turn-based car combat game, and we got loads more over the years. It took a while for the convergence between atmosphere, setting, and actual in-game fun times to really nail things though. But by the mid-90s, we were there, and would you believe it, I was in the early stages of my teen years by that point, so the games I really want to talk about came right from that era. What a wild coincidence, almost as if being that age makes your experience truly formative ones that stick with you and impact you for the rest of your life. And it's either that or Twisted Metal really is one of the best games ever made, I'm not sure. Spoiler alert. Because yes, the mid-90s and on saw the post-apocalyptic car combat genre hit its stride, or rev its engine I guess, with games like the original PlayStation's Twisted Metal launching in 1995, and plenty of others I want to give a mention to here showing up in the years that followed. What we saw was an explosion, pun, in popularity of the genre, a wide variety of titles playing off a central concept and adding in their own spin to things, and, not that long later, a near-complete death of the genre. It was surprisingly short-lived a thing, but it's a thing I look back on with no small sense of fondness. The original Twisted Metal was, of course, a bit shit even by standards of the day. A million hackles may be raised in defense there, but it's true, the game was rough around the edges and felt decidedly cheap. So I'll skip straight on to 1996's sequel, the wittily titled Twisted Metal 2 World Tour, in which you toured the rest of the world and not just the world, aka the United States. Still rough and ready in many ways, TM2 more than made up for its myriad failings by being a really solid fun time. The setup, as with the majority of games in this video it's fair to say, was to drive around and shoot your opponents using a gun-toting vehicle. World Tour was full of a cast of misfits and cartoonish buffoons, as well as Axel, the man car, my hero, each of whom had their own style of play, their own special attacks, their own... It was just those two, really. All the same, there was variety and enjoyment in playing as each different character, and the simple straightforward satisfaction of the action, of blowing up other cars with guns and bombs and missiles and a mechanized digger, was palpable. Especially in multiplayer, even if it was only two-player for the second game. And topping TM2 off like a cherry on a delicious stew was the cutscenes, the storyline. I said there was a convergence between setting and in-game mechanics, remember? Yeah. And Twisted Metal 2 nailed it. It's comic book style cutscenes playing out with some daft but excellent voice acting and a generally thus of, hey, ain't nihilism and ironic twists great? It really managed to bring home the right sort of feel for the world you were in. Yes, the real world wasn't all about to end in nuclear fire anymore, not since the fall of the USSR some years prior, but the game world didn't need that paranoia. It could be mean and dark and, yes, I'll say it, it could be twisted. Something else that was twisted screeched into view and plowed through a pedestrian in 1997 on PC by the name of Carmageddon. And immediately I went off track from my self-made microgenre here by bringing up a game with no guns on the cars, ah well, my video, my rules. Carmageddon was one of the most 90s things that ever happened, and it was fantastic. Mixing a middling racing game with Destruction Derby, then adding in plenty of pedestrians or zombies to kill, and setting it all in a world as cynical as you would expect when it was made in a time the markets were on the up, the US didn't have troops on the ground in any major conflict, and Bill Clinton was in office. No, but seriously, there was a space for real snarky cynicism in this period because nothing actually bad was happening in the US or Europe. Unless you were in the Balkans. Huh. But that's enough 90s societal commentary for now. Carmageddon's winning formula for me was how it was a racing game, but you didn't have to race. You could instead veer wildly off course and smash the crap out of every other competitor to win, or you could kill every civilian or zombie on the course and win. You didn't have to take part in the mediocre racing action. That fact, alongside the twisted attitude, was a complete winner, and not just because I was 14 when Carmageddon came out. But back to the guns. A game known as Interstate 76 hit on PC in 1997, and I've no idea if I'm talking about these games in chronological order, and I didn't play Interstate 76. But from that game came a spin-off in 1998, Vigilante 8. Take your twisted metal, set it in an alternate history that's not post-apocalyptic but verges on it, throw in a school bus, a hippie and a UFO, and you've got yourself one of the best contenders to the car combat throne of all the times. Yes, it was car combat. Twisted metal, but different. More realistic physics, less cartoony weapons, a UFO, but very much twisted metal. It was great, and another formative game for this vague list that I'm almost coming up with as I go along. From there, we ran into a world of sequels. Like I mentioned before, I'm not sure these are chronological, so the order isn't key, but we had Carmageddon 2, which was actually the first of that series that I own myself. And I loved it, because I also had a 3D FX graphics card, so you know I was the coolest kid in school. Nobody was my friend. There were sequels to Twisted Metal 2, too, with TM3 and 4 being rubbish and mediocre, respectively. There's a video about that series I did a while ago. Check it out if I remember to put links to it anywhere here. There was Rogue Trip Vacation 2012, which was seemingly set 11 years ago because time is awful, but the game proved to be the best Twisted Metal sequel on PS1 that nobody played. Vigilante 8 Second Offense showed up and did that car combat shtick well again, though really it should have been called Vigilante 9. Yeah, I just checked and originally it was called Vigilante 12. Huh. There was also a couple of actual good Twisted Metal sequels. No, silly, not Small Brawl. In the shape of Twisted Metal Black and Twisted Metal Head On. Again, a video about those was done. They were good, and hammered home that the core concept in this genre was a pretty timeless one that would work well if done well. And the appetite for car combat led to some surprising entries to the genre. While the post-apocalypticism was dropped in the most part, I'd be remiss if I didn't point out the likes of Star Wars Demolition, which was essentially a reskinned Vigilante 8, and Jack X Combat Racing, which, well, actually that was pretty post-apocalyptic. And I wouldn't be remiss, I'd be legally insane if I didn't mention WWE Crush Hour. THQ's dalliance into the world of car combat via one of its many licenses, the most natural fit the publisher deciding being World Wrestling Entertainment. The game was a hot mess, of course, but it showed how popular the genre was at the time of the game's release in 2003. If even WWE and Star Wars was getting into it, publishers saw an audience there. But it stumbled. None of these licensed or bigger name games found a real audience, and so the car combat genre pootled into obscurity for some time. Fans bleated and bemoaned the lack of a new Twisted Metal, but other than that, things in this mini little tiny subgenre I changed the parameters of all the time had just sort of stopped. 2012 saw the launch of a new Twisted Metal game. Again, I did a video about that series, and somewhat ironically, it was the game that seemed to hammer the final nail into the coffin of the mainstream post-apocalyptic car combat nano genre. A directionless, mediocre game with little of the charm of the earlier games and much of the predatory bullshit of online passes ended it for us all. Now, the genre, the subgenre, whatever, didn't die. Games along these lines still popped up and still do pop up periodically, but the big change is twofold. The game either doesn't have the backing of a big developer or publisher behind it, so tends to drift out and be lost in the noise, or it's a bit of something akin to Twisted Metal or Carmageddon, but enveloped in a broader genre. In that first hole of that twofold, you got things like Gas Guzzlers Extreme, or Nightwolf Survive the Megadome, or even Burndown or Crossout. And they're all a mix of decent or rubbish or undersupported or dead online or... I haven't played Crossout, so I've got no idea, but it looks like it is supported and it's not totally dead online, so maybe it's okay? But none of these were those big mainstream hits of the before times in the long, long ago. Tribute acts playing the old hits or newfangled noise that doesn't sit well with my old man ears. Am I just yearning to be 15 again? No, surely it can't be as simple as that. Oh, and there were mobile games in the sub-tiny genre too, but I can't be arsed with that, to be honest. Please let me know if the spiritual successor to Twisted Metal and Vigilante 8 lives on in mobile form in the comments. But in the second twofold hole, if you were looking at things with the backing of, well, money, you'd end up with something like Rage, id Software's 2011 adventure across all the possible shades of brown a person could ever hope to see. But I actually like the original Rage, more so than its sequel, even though the sequel had Andrew WK on board. So by no means am I one of the many Rage quitters out there. But the seams, I can see them, even with mega textures being used. It just wasn't the same. Nor was it the same with 2015's Mad Max, where GTA fused neatly with a big empty desert and a surprisingly decent game to make something that... Well, I have to say this is probably what I'd have expected from a more modern take on the post-apocalyptic car combat micro subgenre. But no, wasn't the same. Not a narrow enough scope. Not enough of a focus on arena-based blasting in a world already blasted. Ditto Borderlands, which also brought in elements along these lines, but talking about the series makes me remember its sense of humour and now I need to go lobotomise myself because good god. How much I've played the Borderlands series versus how much I actively hate it is another topic for another day. Hardware Rivals was an honest effort from Sony to basically be Twisted Metal without any discernible character or reason to play it more than once, RIP in peace. Destruction All-Stars brought that narrower focus and arena, sure, but it Fortnite-ified a sub-micro-footnote genre that I enjoyed for its reliance on cynical post-apocalyptic tropes, or UFOs in the case of Vigilante 8. Flat Out and Wreckfest would be good starting points, add in more guns and a more post-bomb drop atmosphere, but they were modern-day destruction derbies over anything else. So where does this all leave us? Well, it leaves me playing 20-odd-year-old games, which I'm fine with. It leaves us watching multiplayer competitive arena-based games being hugely popular in the modern era, but few of them involving cars with big stupid guns on them while simultaneously ripping off Mad Max. And none of the ones that do exist come from any companies with real money backing them up. Not that games from small companies can't be good, but you know what I mean. The last Twisted Metal had a lot of Sony money and hype behind it. It's just not the same now. I'm gonna break with Bransfield tradition and be an optimist here, though, which is somewhat ironic given the massively cynical settings of so many of these games I do so love. See, there is a Twisted Metal TV show coming. It'll probably be awful, though it does have Samoa Joe in it, so that's guaranteed to be great. But if it does anything, if it has any impact at all, it could lead to a new era of modern Mad Max ripoffs in game form, taking place in arena-based levels, featuring cars with guns on them, allowing me to make up some weird parameters to class something as a game that belongs in this genre or not. Even though Carmageddon technically shouldn't belong in it. I have some hope. A bit. A smidge. Maybe. Thanks as ever to my mighty patrons on Patreon, the sort of people I would actively avoid running over were I stuck in a post-apocalyptic hellscape forced to fight for my life in trials of vehicular combat, aka Asda Car Park. Zing! I'm off to chop my arms off and have gigantic wheels attached to them, though I'm not sure if I have enough solder for the job. Bye!